In this video, we're going to see how you can solve for the Thevenin resistance when you have dependent sources in your circuit, other than just doing the ratio of V open circuit to I short circuit. And this method involves using a test source. So this is the example we did in the previous video. So I'm just repeating what we found there, that we found that the open circuit voltage between nodes A, B was 5 1/3 volts, and then when we put a short between nodes A, B, we found the short circuit current to be 12 amps, and then that ratio gave us our Thevenin resistance of 0.44 ohms, okay? And again, finding R Thevenin by the ratio of V open circuit to I short circuit, I mean, that will work no matter what kind of circuit you have with whatever sources, whether they're independent, dependent, or a mixture, okay? But as I've stated a couple of times already, but it bears repeating, when you have a dependent source, you can't use the method to find RTH where you leave an open here between nodes A, B, and then you get the R equivalent from the perspective of the load with sources eliminated, because again, as you know, you can't eliminate dependent sources. So anyway, another method when you have a case like this is to use a test source. And you can either use a current test source or a voltage test source, and we'll look at both cases. And first we'll start with using a current test source. So what I've done here is I've taken the circuit, I've eliminated the independent voltage source, okay, so that's where the short comes from, just killing that 6-volt voltage source. Again, I can't kill a dependent source, so I got to leave it in there. And now I'm going to put a current source of value 1 amp between nodes A, B. And if I find the voltage across that test current source, and I do Ohm's law with that voltage across the 1 amp source and divide by its current of 1 amp, that equals the Thevenin resistance. Okay, so that's the whole idea behind this method, is you put a test current source of this value, 1 amp, and then find the voltage across it, do Ohm's law with those two values, and that's also equal to the Thevenin resistance. So let's go ahead and show that we get the same answer using this test current source as we got with VOC divided by I short circuit. So you can see here I'm using mesh current method. So I defined the mesh currents that you can see here. Actually, I forgot to put in a couple of polarity symbols for the voltage across the 4 ohm resistor. So let me do that real quick. See, I forgot to put the orange plus here, and then also put the red plus at the bottom, just to be complete. Okay. Alright, so now let's go ahead and let's write our mesh current equations. Well, first of all, remember from when we talked about mesh current that if you have a single mesh current defined through a current source, well, that mesh current is equal to that current source value. So you see I1 is just equal to 1 amp. Okay, also, we have a super mesh, right? Because I2 and I3 are both defined through this dependent current source, so that's a super mesh. So our super mesh KVL will be around this mesh right here that excludes the dependent current source. So we have KVL for the super mesh. And let's see, starting with the 5 ohm resistor, we're going to have 5I3. Then at the 3 ohm resistor, we're going to have plus 3I2. And then at the 4 ohm resistor, we'll have plus 4I2. And then minus 4I1. Alright, that equals 0. Okay, so that's our KVL for the supermesh. Then remember, when we have a supermesh, we have an equation that we get from the dependent source that the difference of I2 and I3 equals the value of the dependent current source, which is 1.5 Ix. So Let's see, it's going to be I2, which is flowing with the arrow of the current source, minus I3, which is flowing against the arrow of the current source, and that equals 1.5 Ix. So you see now I've got, you know, this Ix, the variable that the dependent current source depends on, well, that introduces another unknown. So I need to have an equation that relates Ix to what I'm solving for, which are the mesh currents I1, I2, and I3. So if you look right here where Ix is defined, it's the current through the 3 ohm, and the only mesh current defined through the 3 ohm is I2. So I2 equals Ix. Okay, so now you can go ahead and solve for the mesh currents. And you see the mesh current we're interested in, and this is the only one I solved for, is I2, right? We already know I1 is 1 amp. Now, the reason we want to get I2 is because if I know I1 and I2, I can get the current through the 4 ohm, and then I can get the voltage across the 4 ohm. And if I know the voltage across the 4 ohm, well, that is the voltage across this test current source, because this 1 amp test current source and that 4 ohm resistor, they're in parallel, and we know that voltages are the same in parallel. So you see, just from our fundamentals, you know, that we learned real early in the quarter, right, we know that the voltage across the test current source, okay, so put a T here for test current source, is going to equal the voltage across that 4 ohm resistor, right? So actually, to use the same notation, I should really put that, you know, this is equal to the voltage across the 1 amp test current source. So, you know, I'll just scratch that away. I don't want to, you know, use notation that's going to cause any unnecessary confusion. Okay? So, if you go ahead and you solve for I2, I2 will come out to 0.888, and you know, you can keep on going with all these eights, amps. So we've got 1 amp going one direction from top or bottom to top of the 4 ohm, and then we've got I2 going the other direction from top to bottom through the 4 ohm. So the current through the 4 ohm is just the difference. Okay, so that's 0.111, you know, as far out as you want to take those ones. Okay, so now the voltage across the 4 ohm will just be 4 times that, so 4 times 0.111, and that equals 0.444 volts. Okay, and now we take that, we plug it in over here. So our RTH is 0.44 volts divided by 1 amp. Okay, which of course is the same answer as what we got with VOC divided by I short circuit. See, we get the same answer. Okay, you see the value of this current source is really arbitrary. You could make that current source any value and you'll get the same answer. It's just we choose to make it 1 amp because once we find the voltage, well then that will be the resistance, right, since we're dividing by 1. So, you know, we choose a 1 amp current source just to make this last step easy. Okay, but you can see that we got the same answer with this test source method using a test current source. Well, you can also use a test voltage source. So let's go ahead and do the same problem using a test voltage source. Again, just to show we'll get the same answer as in the two previous cases. So when you use a test voltage source, you still eliminate the independent voltage source like we did last time, right? So all of this is the same here, this part of the circuit. It's just now between nodes A, B, we put a 1 volt voltage source. That's our test source. And if we find the current for that test voltage source and do Ohm's law with the 1 volt and that current, that's RTH. So in this problem, to solve this, I use node voltage method. And I made this bottom node ground, Okay, so this bottom node, node B here, this is all ground. Okay, here, this is known because we're connecting a voltage source right to it, so that's 1 volt right there. So we only have this unknown node here that I'll just label C. Okay, node C. So KCL, since we're doing node voltage method, it's KCL at C. Alright, but I gotta define my currents. This one's defined for me. I'll say there's a current like this, I1. And I'll say, well, this is already defined for us. That's IX flowing out. Okay, so that's already defined for us. So let's see, I've got I1 plus 1.5 IX. Those are the currents flowing into node C. And then I have just IX flowing out. Okay, then I1 in terms of voltage, it's going to be 0 minus VC over 5. Okay, then this is going to be 1.5 times IX. IX is just going to be VC minus 1. Okay, remember, we have 1 volt here. That's the test source value. And that's divided by 3. And that's going to equal VC minus 1 over 3. Those are equal signs there. That's an equal sign. All right, so we have one equation, one unknown in terms of VC. And if you solve this, you'll get that VC equals minus 5 volts. Okay, so right here at this node on the left side of this 3 ohm resistor is minus 5 volts with respect to ground. Okay, so now we're going to take this answer and find the current for the 1 volt test source, right? Because that's what we're after. Okay, well look, I can find the current through the 3 ohm now. I can get its actual value because I now know that on the right side, well I knew that at the start, on the right side there was 1 volt with respect to ground. But now I know after solving the node voltage equation that there's minus 5 volts on the left side of the 3 ohm with respect to ground. So you see the current through this 3 ohm is really going right to left. It's going to flow from 1 volt to minus 5 volts, right? Because as we've seen many times and as you should have ingrained now is that current through a resistor goes from the higher end to the lower end, right? It's always going to drop voltage as current flows through it. So that current is going to be 1 minus 5 over 3. That's the current through the 3 ohm. And then the current through the 4 ohm also is going to be flowing out of this node A, right? This current through the 3 is flowing out, and also this current through the 4 ohm is going to flow out because it's going to flow from 1 volt to ground. So both the currents through the resistors are flowing out of node A, which means the current for this test source has to be flowing into node A. Right, because at least one of the currents has to be flowing in, and at least one of the currents has to be flowing out of a node, as you know. So this is just going to be 1 minus 0 over 4. So if you go ahead and work out these numbers, it comes out to 6 over 3, which is 2 plus a quarter. So 2 1/4 amps. All right, so now if we plug in for RTH, we've got 1 volt divided by 2 1/4 amps. All right, and that comes out to, you guessed it, 0.44 ohms. Okay, same answer as we got the two previous methods. Okay, so again, these were just two examples of using the test source method to find RTH, which you can use when you have dependent sources in your circuit. Now, a lot of times students will ask, well, what's better, the test current source or the test voltage source method? Again, a lot of times it's just personal preference, but make sure that you can do both, because you could be asked to do either one of them,